So, in this video segment, I want to go ahead and talk about the relatively recent macroeconomic history of the United States by looking at the Phillips curve. And in this particular graph here, I have the Phillips curve for the year 1960 to 1968. And you can see we start here in 1960. The economy is actually about to slip into a recession, and it does slip into the recession in the election year and continues into the early Kennedy administration. So the unemployment rate gets up around 6.5% or so. And then as the economy starts to recover and the unemployment rate drops, inflation slowly starts to heat up. So 61, 62, 63, 64, 65. And one of the things that's happening during this period is, of course, that the Vietnam War is getting underway, and the government is spending a lot of money on that. Also, to some degree, the government is increasing its spending on the war on poverty and that sort of thing. And to sort of be a good supporter of both of those initiatives, the Federal Reserve keeps interest rates nice and low, which is what it had historically done in previous major wars like World War II and that sort of thing. So then we go up here to 66, 67, and 68. And you can see that this looks pretty much like we would expect a Phillips curve to look. And sort of something that was sort of famous in the history of economists, at least, is that as we're going through the 60s, one economist, Milton Friedman, sort of says, hey, wait a second here, this sort of Phillips curve thing, it doesn't quite 100% make sense theoretically, because we tend to think that real economic variables, like the unemployment rate, can't be influenced in the long run by purely nominal variables, things like monetary policy or the inflation rate. So he sort of comes up with, you know, this idea that the short-run Phillips curve can't be all there is, and there is such a thing as a natural rate of unemployment. And that was not part of Keynesian economics, sort of in its earliest and most primitive stages. So he sort of comes up with this warning or exception. And, you know, so far, though, everything looks perfectly consistent with the normal short-run Phillips curve story. But then what happens is 1969, we go a little bit farther up the Phillips curve. And then we jump out here in 1970. And the Phillips curve says you're essentially supposed to be going back and forth along this kind of curve. But now we seem to have jumped out, and we have both more unemployment and higher inflation. And you can kind of see where it looks like there's kind of a new Phillips curve in this region as opposed to the old Phillips curve, which was over here. So this is sort of our new short-run Phillips curve. And notice that sort of we had had inflation gradually creeping up throughout the late 1960s. And then eventually, people start building that inflation into their expectations. Everyone expects that prices are just going to go up by a little bit every year. So everyone starts building that into their behavior. Firms start building price increases into contracts. Unions and firms agree to sort of gradual price rises over the course of, say, a three-year contract to sort of compensate for the expected inflation and so on and so forth. And then sort of we go 1970 here, 71, 72, and 73. And one thing to notice here is that in sort of the popular mythology of the 1970s, it's the fact that there are disruptions in oil markets which caused the inflation. But notice inflation had already been creeping up sort of gradually even before we get our first oil shock in early 1973. Now that said, it's true that an increase in oil prices is going to mean a leftward shift, a bad shift, in short-run aggregate supply. And as we had talked about in the previous video, a bad or leftward shift in short-run aggregate supply means you have both higher prices and lower GDP, which is the same as saying higher inflation and higher unemployment. So that's exactly consistent with being on a new Phillips curve out here. And then ultimately what the Federal Reserve does is it faces a choice now. It can go ahead and tighten monetary policy to try and fight the inflation, but that will cause unemployment to go up. Or it can go ahead and keep monetary policy what's called accommodating and mostly worry about making sure unemployment doesn't get too high and sort of not worry so much about the inflation. And sort of a little bit as we're going through the 1970s, you can see that we're in this sort of pattern of sort of spiraling upwards. Because historically, over the course of the 1970s, the Federal Reserve decides that it wants to accommodate these supply shocks. And so we end up with this gradually increasing inflation rate, but notice sort of the unemployment rate is still always in this sort of, you know, 5.5 to 8, you know, et cetera kind of range here. So even though we're getting higher and higher inflation, unemployment isn't sort of coming down in a systematic and sustained way. It's sort of fluctuating around in this range around the natural rate of unemployment. Then finally, sort of out here in 1979, things get really crazy. We have this second oil shock as the government of Iran is overthrown, and that drives inflation up again. And the Federal Reserve at first accommodates that inflation, and we get a really high inflation rate. But then Paul Volcker is nominated as Federal Reserve, so Jimmy Carter puts him in and says, okay, we just need to just slay this inflationary dragon. And he just really tightens up the monetary policy a lot. And you can see that we start going down along the Phillips curve. So we bring down inflation at the cost of increased unemployment. And then, you know, we're driving the economy into a recession, essentially, to get rid of the inflation. And Paul Volcker says, you know, we're just going to keep on doing this. Now, there's some evidence that due to sort of basic just mistakes and misunderstandings on how fast the economy was going into a recession, that the recession was perhaps more severe than was planned. But you can see that, you know, unemployment gets pretty high here, up around 9%, but we do cut the inflation rate in about half. And then gradually, this process of disinflation, of sort of squeezing the inflation out of the economy, is going to continue. So here we are in 1982. The economy is just recovering from a recession. The fact that inflation has come down means that people's expected inflation goes down. So we get this sort of nice drop in inflation without any further increase in unemployment as we have the Phillips curve shift left, because a decrease in inflationary expectations means firms are no longer raising their prices by so much every year. So we have this sort of leftward shift of the Phillips curve, and gradually the Federal Reserve, people start to believe that it is a credible inflation fighter, and sort of, you know, 1983, 84, 85, there's some good luck here. OPEC falls apart, and so we get the benefits of a reverse oil shock, and oil prices fall. And eventually you can see we've got a sort of Phillips curve in this region. Further on into the 90s, after a recession in the early 90s, that brings down inflation a little bit more. And by the sort of middle 90s, the Federal Reserve is really sort of established that it is a credible inflation fighter. And we have these nice low inflation numbers over here, with also a pretty nice unemployment rate here in sort of the 5 to 6% range. And this is sort of even before we get the tech boom of the late 90s. So what happened to the tech boom of the late 90s? Well, we sort of start going up this Phillips curve again. Inflationary expectations start to rise, and you can see that we end up in a Phillips curve in this neighborhood. And then inflationary expectations are just starting to rise again at the tail end of the housing boom. And you can see that we can sort of be on another Phillips curve out in this neighborhood. And then finally, you know, this is where we are out here in 2012. It's a little bit mysterious why we would have this movement out here that would seem to put us on a Phillips curve in this neighborhood. It's pretty hard to argue that inflationary expectations could have risen very much, since the inflation rate has been declining over this time period. So essentially, that's the short macroeconomic history of the last half of the 20th century and the first half of, or the first part of this decade.